So, Chip for Makers, I think I was here at OrfCon 2 or 3 years ago, and I presented there for my first, and now I want to give you what the status is now. So, this is overview of my talk. I first talk to why a demo chip I want to do, some test chips, what the future will be, and then the end of my talk, hopefully. Yeah, like already said, since 95 I'm employed at IMEC. It's called Europe's biggest microelectronics research institute. When I start to work there, then they got a PR department and they say micro is not small enough, so they call it now Nanoelectronics Research Institute. Since 8 years I'm working in the full custom design group, mainly on standard cells and I/O libraries, and a SRAM compiler for space applications. There I'm in contact with our ASIC services group, where one of our big founders we provide service for is TSMC. So if you want to make chips at TSMC and you have less than 1,000 wafers to produce, then you have to go to a company like IMEC. And like I already said, from next Tuesday on, I quit my job at IMEC. I'm going full-time for this chip for makers. So what is the purpose? What I want to achieve is to have a low-cost, low-volume ASIC service and also NDA-free. So that's a boundary condition I want to put on. So in the opposite of Louis, that's for me, my customers should not have to sign an NDA, and I will only do things where my customers don't need to sign an NDA. I think I'm targeting makers. I don't think makers want to sign an NDA. So what does it mean? So I target startup cost over performance. So you will not get very high performance. I'm targeting more Arduino type performance than Raspberry Pi type performance, to give you the boundary of my type. So we are use all the technologies because they have low startup costs. So typically for a new technology, the startup cost doubles at the old times. For the newer technologies, I don't really know the startup cost. It's just too much. It's millions of dollars. So, and also using these older technologies relax the requirements that you have to put on the toolchain. You have Louis yesterday who said there's these power tools, these timing tools, signal integrity tools, they were missing. Actually, for PON 35, which I'm using, you mainly don't need them. It was golden age, so timing was done by your gates and not by the interconnects. You don't have signal integrity problems. If your clock tree is a little bit okay, you don't have hold violations and all these things. But you still need a low-cost toolchain to be able to make your chip. And if you go to Cadence or Synopsys, your license cost will be more than your silicon cost for this older technology now. So that's why I need open source tools, and that's why I'm here at OrfConf. So the first, I also doing a demo project of what is possible with this flow. And I think in the retro computing world, there are quite some people who want to pay a little bit more for a chip that is performing less. That's why I wanted to go for the, I'm an old Amiga freak. So if you know what people pay there for an accelerator with a Motorola 68000 with 100 megahertz processor on it, it's more than what you pay for a Raspberry Pi now. Much more, it's 5 times as much. So I wanted to do that as a showcase. So I combined then some retro, a Z80, a MOS 6502, and then a Motorola 68000. It's based on computers like the ZX81, the Commodore 64, the Commodore Amiga, the Ataris, these things. With 4K on-chip RAM, with 5-volt digital IOs and all these things, that's what I planted. And then I plan to have different product options that you have an Arduino type board, a prototyping type board, and I presented it in 2018 at FOSDEM. I did a crowdfunding on CrowdSupply, and then I did not succeed in this crowdfunding. You see, I only got 4,000, $22,000 of the $22,000 I wanted to have for this project. And I also followed the forums, different fora, where this was discussed. And you had an Arduino guy, and he says, yeah, it costs more than an Arduino, and it does less than an Arduino. So they are interested in getting things done, and they are not so much interested if it's open source or not. Then you have an open source guy. Yeah, it's very nice that you're doing open source things, but I don't need an Arduino board. It's for these makers. It's not for me. And then you have the retro computing guy who says, yes, where is your memory bus? I want to couple some things to it, and you don't have a memory bus. I also had only at general purpose IOs. So luckily, I could inspire one guy. He's called Jeff Carr. He's now doing, he's more in the cloud computing. He was a founder of DigitalOcean, and now he's doing wit.com. And he said, yeah, I like what you're doing, and I want to sponsor your project. So although the crowd supply failed, he gave me the money to make the retro computing chip. That's why I'm now here. And I'm now planning to include an external memory interface, more peripherals. And originally, I only used NMeGen or MeGen for some sub-blocks. I'm now going for MeGen for the top level because I feel more confident to make something that works when I use MeGen on top than if I use VHDL or RTL on top. Okay, so, and we also decided to do some test chip before doing the final retro microcontroller. So, and I have done up to now three tape outs, so I will quickly go over them. So, the first tape out was actually just four proprietary SRAM blocks of TSMC connected to their proprietary IO cells just to see the flow working. But I also included a thing where I put two dice next to each other that I can get these, because actually, currently, my 1/3 of my cost is based in the subdicing of the dice at TSMC and then packaging. So if I could reduce that, so I have now some test chips. If I can reduce the startup cost of subdicing and packaging, I can reduce also the startup cost for my chips. The next step out is that I did some cores. I took Arlet's MOS 6502 Verilog implementation, put it through Qflow, and I used the OZU, which is also from a university in America. The name escapes me now. A standard cell library. That standard cell library has four. So the 0.35 technology has four metal layers. But all three metal layers have the same pitch, but the standard cell still had a bigger pitch on the top metal four layers. So I reduced this pitch, and then you can see that I gain 27% in area just by reducing, because I need less overhead in the standard cells itself. And I also included there an open RAM 1K block, but it was not really optimized at that moment, so it was somewhere in last year or so. And then that SRAM block has four times the size of the TSMC compared one. So we need to improve that to be able to have on-chip SRAM open source for the chips. And then the third tape out, which actually happened last Tuesday. So I've been had a stressful, so I quit my job, but I had still a stressful time. But the original plan was to have a minimal version of my retro computing, but I needed to reduce the scope for the moment. What I already did, I started doing, is that originally I had top in VHDL, MeGen for sub-blocks. I switched to NMeGen and implemented top in MeGen. I still need to do some of the peripheral works because I discovered that the place and route tools are not, and then I switched to focusing on the place and route tools. The Qflow You know Kuflow is the flow by Tim Edwards, which is also used by eFabless now. It has Qrouter, it uses Yosys. Together with these open source standard cells, it's not efficient enough. You just need too much overhead to be able to get it routed for these big designs. And I have access to proprietary TSMC standard cells, but neither Qflow or Coriolis were able to handle them. Qflow can only work with pitches which are a multiple. So the higher level pitches have to be a multiple of one of the base pitches. And the standard cell library was not that, and Coriolis did not really understand the abstract views of the cells, so the left files for the people who know what this is. And also there was no good solution for connecting the pins. Louis also yesterday mentioned that, for connecting the pins of your digital sub-block to the I/O ring. So I had to do that. I have implemented that now with manual scripting in K-layout. But anyway, I could do some tape-outs. There I switched to only one core and not the three cores. I have a T80, which is its Z80 implementation. It contains the GTAC interface, the on-chip SRAM. It has an external SRAM interface, and it had 56 GPIO pins at the moment. But because this is FastDL, I also now using Symbiotic EDA, which they have a proprietary extension for their Yosys, so you can handle VHDL. They use Verific for that. And I use this reduced metal for standard cells. And I also have then the same tape out with a MOS 6502 core. And you can see that the MOS 6502 is much smaller than the Z80. And the timing reports report that they ran almost at the same frequency, but I think the Z80 needs double amount of cycles to get the same thing done. So to me, the MOS 6502 seems to be more efficient if you can live with an 8-bit CPU, of course. And I also put some first 5-fold test I/O structures to be able to have my own 5-fold I/O standard cells. And I also did the first version of the MOS 6502 handled with Coriolis, but this is not connected out because I had problems with connecting this to the I/O. So it's just there for reference. I had it, so I just included it in the design. So these are my test tape outs. So what I will do in the future, so for my retro Phoenix, is finish the RTL implementation, of course, mainly MeeGen and MeeGen programming. Of course, I have now a lot of chips. I also need to test them. So I'm happy. Of course, it's full of proprietary stuff, but the SRAM chip has been tested and it worked. I was happy because I did the layout and connection fully manually. I didn't have a good LVS check and all the things, and it still worked. So it really surprised me that it worked. So probably people will say, you got lucky. So I hope I still get lucky in the future also. I will come back to that. And that's the problem. I need to introduce a real verification toolchain, because up to now, I just considered that everything was bug-free, and I just hope that everything will work as it goes. I know this is and I have been thinking, should I delay my tape out, but I still feel I learn enough of this tape out, and even if the chips don't work, why they don't work, and I can then make the next tape out working here in that way. So I will need to optimize the placer outflow, so we have to reduce this overhead on the standard cells a lot. And likely I will switch to Coriolis with NSX slip, design the I/O cells, replace the proprietary VHDL solutions now with open source ones. I already talked with Pepin and Tristan, so we will probably be in contact about that. And also optimize the SRAM compiler. I just saw that there's been a lot of activity on the SRAM compiler recently, so I have to reinvestigate that. And then the next thing is that I have the Ships for Makers beta thing. And I want to invite you, if you have some design, you can join my tape out, my next tape out. And this is the estimated prices, is that for 1750 euros, you can make 50 chips. So if I count right, it's for 7 corporate tickets of FORCONF, you can get 50 chips of your own with your own design on it. And then if you order more chips, the price will go down. The exact pricing will be determined at tape out, but I don't expect it to go up. If it's adapted, it will go down if we can make improvement in the packaging. And also, commitment is only needed at that point. So, but what are the boundary conditions? I don't have a tape out schedule yet. So if I test the chips and I see something strange, I have to test them. And so it's difficult to predict. It will be a fixed package with the DC pins fixed and the GTAC pins fixed to certain pins. But you get 92 pins that you can choose yourself. And if you want to join, you can even split these pins up between different people. The toolchain is under development, so you have to be able to actually cooperate. But I think that's a feature for the people all here and not a boundary condition. But of course, I hope this will be looked at online. If you want to have on-chip RAM and maybe the IO cells will still be priority, so strong reciprocal or copyleft things will maybe not be possible for the first design. But you know, I already expressed that I prefer a strong reciprocal, but that's the plan to go in the future. So all digital should be possible to there. Custom analog design could still be possible, but then you have to take risk that if the chip doesn't work, yeah, that you have lost your money. So if you bet at Chips for Makers, if you're interested. I also applied for Point 18 process development for NLNet funding. In the application is also a tool to convert the PDK rules of the foundry to open tools, something that Louise also mentioned. So this is then the end of my talk, but also hopefully the beginning of my adventure and my company. So come and join me, and here is my contact information.
So would it be possible to do like a 1 kilogate equivalent design with like 2K SRAM?
1 kilobit?
One kilogate the RTL design and...
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. There fit more gates on than on an IS-40, the biggest IS-40. So the... Yeah, of course, if I can reduce the efficiency of the planar route. The original planning of my retro computer was done on the standard cell library of TSMC, and the Motorola 68000 processor itself does not fit on the IS-40, but it fits on this design. So I think it's more 25,000 gates that you can have, plus then 4 kilobytes of SRAM.
What's the status of the 3 tape outs you mentioned? Have you got them back? Are they working?
I only got the first one back. Yeah, actually the second one also got them back, but was in the same time when I was doing the tape out of the next one. So that will be now in the future. But now I'm full time on this. So I also plan to blog more on my blog about this, on the progress I make on these things.
So for approximately 2K euro, you'll get the chip back and be packaged and bonded?
Yes.
Brilliant. Thank you.
This is awesome. I'm pleased to see that you're back up and running with this. So maybe you said, who's the fab? Is it TSMC?
It's TSMC 0.35,
okay.
Yes.
Okay, 0.35. And then for the 0.18, also likely TSMC?
It's undecided, but I have the best network link with the TSMC guys, okay. With IMEC.
Cool.
But if somebody gives me better conditions than what I can get from IMEC, I will do it in another foundry.
Yeah. And how many square mil is that? Like, how much? What's the maximum silicon
you
put in there?
I need, so I didn't say it. So this is together with the retro, the beta version. So because of the retro computer being, but it's actually an MPW. I divide in four. An MPW is 25 square millimeter, and I divide it in four, so it's 6 square millimeter, including the IO ring. Yes. Yeah.